Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today for day two of our Youth and Buddhism series hosted by North America's Sakyamuni Foundation. Yesterday was the first day of our talk series where we had His Eminence Asanga Roger Rinpoche, who engaged with the youth on the theme of survival, contextualizing Tibetan youth and their complexities. To provide a brief recap of that conversation, we covered a range of topics relevant to the experiences of Tibetan youth, including our struggles with mental health, the contradictions of being a Buddhist in the West, the spiritual disconnect, managing the stress of living in the digital age of social media, and dealing with death through a Buddhist perspective. We would like to thank His Eminence Asanga Roger Rinpoche for an enriching discussion that left so many of us feeling so encouraged and inspired. The theme for today's talk is Thrival, Resilience and Flourishment of Tibetan Youth. Similar to yesterday, the topic for today's conversation were developed from our youth participants through the registration form. Some of those topics include why Buddhism matters and how we can practice it in our lives. Today's programming will follow this agenda, starting with introductory remarks by His Eminence Avigritha Roger Rinpoche, followed by some time for discussion. The program, again, will be in English. However, participants are welcome to ask their questions in either English or Tibetan. We are so grateful to have His Eminence Avigritha Roger Rinpoche join us for the conversation today. Avigritha Rinpoche is a leading figure in the new generation of Sankhya scholars, practitioners, and teachers. He founded the Marichi Fellowship to coordinate community welfare projects. He is the head lama of the Sakya Monastery of Tibetan Buddhism in Seattle, as well as the Sakya Heritage Society in New Delhi. Rinpoche is also the author of the book titled Wake Up to What Matters. Please welcome His Eminence Avigritha Roger Rinpoche for introductory remarks.
I mean, we can go back and forth, but I just want to save time and Peter guide us through that. So if there's any questions, please.
So if we have any questions, please raise your hand. We'll come by the mic and we'll collect the questions.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Peter. So my question is, in today's age of social media,
my name is Tara Living and I'm 12 years old. I was like watching as I go many people home and but sometimes I wonder how does it help? So my question is, how does reciting mantras benefit us? Thank you.
Clearly lead you to like a better path, not like somewhere else. they're like immigrants and they're born in like a different country than me. So they have different beliefs. What are some ways that I can get them to like understand my needs as someone who's born like in Chile and like who has different needs as my parents?
Can you repeat that?
Sorry. So like how can I get my parents to understand me in like a different perspective from theirs?
One more.
Actually, I mean, as a Buddhist, I do believe in reincarnation and doing good in the present, and of course, being, living a better life in the afterworld by doing so. But I often sometimes have fear over death, and I was just wondering if you could speak on how to cope with that as, you know, as a normal human being and kind of what to expect.
See, 2 months ago, when Kim Bodhara asked to show me this program discussion, we were asked to give a short address. And although the title was You and Buddhism, but the topics seemed specifically about culture rather than Dharma. And I must admit, if it's about our culture surviving, I would really prefer to talk about that. But we've been requested to talk in English, so today we'll begin just by looking in about how Buddhism and our culture converge. Now, about this so-called complexities that's been viewed culturally, here's the thing. It's not for me to tell you what they are. It's for me to hear and listen to what you all have to say. So, yes, I prefer to listen to them. However, although I just turned 30, of course that's not how you're used to that right now, in a month, I don't know if I'll count as a bit of youth anymore. I mean, I do feel one, so just go along with that. Because what I would like to share right now, and I'll go along with the questions and as much as I can, is what I personally found helpful regarding a life as a Tibetan. Because although, I was born in America, in Seattle, Washington, but I went to India from a very young age, the age of 4, to a small little Tibetan settlement where we are totally spoiled. I spent there for 8 years living with my maternal grandparents, their family. Mostly just to get used to the culture, the language, and the environment. So I was very, very fortunate to have that childhood. And the facilities, the conditions in this area is very different from now. I mean, we have 2 channels on TV, power cuts a lot, a 1 hour children's show to watch. Internet did not exist in our lives. It was back at the time we're going outside to play. So, yes, we have that kind of, we have this, to get to live in our little oasis of better culture in total safety and freedom. Now, if when we leave that oasis and navigate the differences and the pressures, the expectation, the temptations, and the goals in life of adulthood displaced from our homeland, and we really feel the impact of being raised in our own culture. But yeah, culture. Culture means language. It means the regional dialects, our cuisine, our costumes, our customs, our songs, our dances, and all of that. When we're displaced from our homeland, and especially if we don't stay in a contained dependent settlement, we all have the struggle of not being able to live those aspects of our settlement. But mainly at home or at the weekends. So, because of all of that, we stop being Tibetan. We stop being Tibetan if we eat Cheerios or Fruit Loops for breakfast instead of Tsamba. Or when we wear jeans and t-shirts instead of churros. Or we dance to music like K-pop instead of traditional Tibetan dances. I mean, if that's the case, then our culture is in deep danger. I don't think so. Yeah, I think our culture is much better. Much, much better. And for me, at least, see, to me, what makes me feel connected to my Tibetan fellows, it makes me feel Tibetan to my core, that I'm living a Tibetan way of life. Is that no matter where I am and what I do, is that the riches, our rich spiritual tradition, this spiritual culture called Tibetan Buddhism, the Dharma. Now, one thing I noticed is that traveling to different places and countries and the different cities where you have museums, they talk about and show the culture and the history. Now, a lot of the time, the main showcase of their costumes and things like that is about war, you know, about their military history, like either colonizing or being colonized, like, you know, those army uniforms, medal of honor that you see in movies, all of that. See, now that tends to be the emphasis. And that is part of the world's culture. But so is ours. When people think of Tibetan culture, majority of them are not thinking about army uniforms, wars, crown jewel being stolen from another colonizing country. No. But they tend to think, the first thing that comes up in their heads is about Buddhist rule, calm, meditation, peace, compassion. And that's one thing that you can be very proud of. So our job is not to relegate this, the world's richest culture of peace and compassion into a costume in a museum. Our job is to keep that cultural wisdom. Keep that cultural wisdom that the world needs more than ever. To keep it alive, to keep it active, to keep it flourishing as much as we can. And His Holiness the Dalai Lama always says that and reminds us that that's on us. The future of our culture is our spiritual tradition, all in our hands. So, now, what's the dharma for us as Tibetan youth in the 21st century? How do we keep it alive? How do we be motivated by it to keep it alive? So that's these are kind of the questions that are so important for us to think deeply and take it to heart. Because it's It's in our hearts, it's in our minds that the Dharma is great. So now, if we go by the definition of the mind, just to be our brain, our ordinary thoughts or feelings, then we got a big problem. Because then we can only talk about promoting a conditioned happiness. It's a dependent and impermanent basis for happiness in our lives, like our thoughts. And we can imagine beautiful things and imagine things that can really make us happy. But a lot of the time, feelings grab hold of the mind and, you know, beyond our control. It can bring us in agony, worse than any physical pain. And we've all been through that, right? So what we call the mind is not just about the brain or our thoughts or feelings. There is no pill, there's no injection that can create true happiness in our mind. The only way that we can try to understand the true nature of our mind, then it is by the mind that we can unlock this true happiness. So, we can say that although we have these incredible human brains, and although our thoughts and feelings can be very powerful, what the Buddha taught about the mind, it's more than that. There is a fall of awareness. It's like a light that allows whatever that appears to be inside of us. So this appearance, this light, we cannot grab hold of it. We can't analyze it under a microscope. We can't find its home in any parts of the brain or body. We can't see its color. We can't describe its shape. We can't pinpoint its beginning, its middle, and end. And because we cannot describe it, we cannot define it in any of those ways, we tend to talk about the mind in terms of what it's being affected by. Of course, that's not the mind itself. We're talking about the states of the mind being affected. Is being affected by impermanent condition. So, and then there are these temporary clouds of addiction and confusion all around. But then there's the sun of our Buddha nature. It's always there, as within us, as the true nature, as the seed of Sukhata. Now I'll get to that more in a bit, but basically what I'm trying to say is that this sun, this Buddha nature that we possess, is not some kind of mystical gift that we have to ask some God, or like, it's not like a higher power. It's not something that some people have more than others. It's there between every thought and thought. Whether we're good, whether we've done bad, whether we like it or not, that is our love. Okay. So, coming to one of the questions, there's no exact word to translate dharma to English actually. Now, generally speaking, the dharma means two things, a verbalized dharma and a realized dharma. Now, the verbalized dharma is the teachings that the Buddha gave. There are many parts to it. One part talks about
the best way of living in the world.
feeling stress on ourselves and others. And that's one part. One part mainly talks about how to purify the world, how to purify the mind from the disturbing emotions like anger, sadness, jealousy, fear, and so on and so forth. That's why we meditate. That's why we do mind training practices. Another part talks about the nature of reality for us to see directly. It's the teachings that we study, that we contemplate, that we meditate on to gain a deeper understanding of the truth. So now, here's the thing. The truth. I know this is going to sound very cliche, but the truth is what sets us free. Seeing the truth directly, and I don't mean like a hunch, or just a hunch, or through blind faith, or through even being smart in a regular sense, but through awakened wisdom, a knowing that's beyond all blocks and all stains. And then, we are home. We've awakened the Buddha within us. We have realized the Dhamma. So, the Dhamma means the Buddha's dispensations of teachings and practices and the truth of the way things really are. Which the Buddha pointed out that it is the seeing of which liberates us from all suffering. So, yeah. Looking into the deeper sense of what the Dharma is for is so important. Because we can say, I'm a Buddhist. I'm from a Buddhist family. I'm really interested in Buddhism. We can wear malas on our wrists, we can put it on our necks, we can start going to certain chakras about the monastery, we can start chanting prayers, we can start offering kalas, do offerings, and ring bells, and do the flute instruments, and receive countless initiations and empowerments and all of that. But if we don't have the deeper sense of what the Dharma is for, then big deal. It won't make much difference from going to some weekend club that we go to, learning all the rules, going along just to please our parents. So the Dharma is much more than that. The Dharma is something that can bring true happiness and true benefit for ourselves and others. So the thing is, or for me at least, see, when I was young, I used to think that, there's so much that I've got to learn. There's all these complicated texts, there's all these prayers, there's all these rituals that I have to learn, that I have to memorize, there's all these meditations that I have to keep on track, there's all these rules that I have to get right, and so on. So, being a Buddhist sounds pretty hard. But then one of my teachers, Rayon, said this quote by the Buddha. He said, "The woodlands are so huge, we only need a handful of leaves to know the entire forest." Same, another great master from ancient India, Narada, called Nagarjuna, he said that we don't have to train a huge number of things to achieve our goals. We can just do it by focusing on one thing. Start to spread that power into other practices, such Years ago when I was in my village, this was before I went to a monastery with all this lifestyle. Believe it or not, I used to be in the ice cream business. Yeah. See, what I'd do is that me and my grandmother, we used to milk the cows every morning. And 10% of that milk, I get to keep. So that 10%, what I do is that I put it in those sprinkles of cups, fill a little sugar, honey, and into the sticks, and put it in the freezer. There, boom, you got your milk ice cream. So I actually, me and my friends, we started a shop and we started selling them. And business was good. Most of our customers were typical moms, actually. But during festivals, festivals, carnivals, and so on. So we in Hindi we call it mela. I'm sure you've all heard of this. So during that time, a lot of customers show up. So me and my grandmother always had, he gave me the milk and then made the ice creams with my friends, and we started this shop and we started selling. Now there was this one point that a group of very poor Indian children came up, and they really wanted those ice cream. And they didn't have any money. So I felt very bad, and I felt this, you know, I felt very compassionate towards them, and I just gave it away for free. What happened was that they started calling their other friends. So more and more of them showed up, and I had to give it all away. Now, I was responsible for this shop during that hour. And I gave it all away. And it felt so rewarding to see the reaction, expressions in their faces, the joy. Later on, me and my business associates had a big fight. They didn't really like me setting up this is giving away all those free ice creams. So when I went back home, I was kind of scared of my grandmother, who was very prepared that she was going to yell at me for wasting all those ice creams. So I told her the truth why I gave them away. And she hugged me. And she said, "I'm so proud that you gave them away because you felt compassion." My grandmother was she did JNC, Adivedeshwara mantra and so on every day. So she was very happy that I did something in a compassionate act. Giving out those ice creams. And from since then, I love practice and generosity, and I have this encouragement on top of that, with this quote of the Buddha that made me enthusiastic to practice compassion and to other practices. So yeah, that's how the business went down. So yeah, things like that, focusing on one particular practice like compassion, makes such a benefit, it gives us a big impact to our practice and our way of life. Now, if we go in deeply, we can explore Buddhist ethics, Buddhist science, Buddhist psychology, and we can say that. But if we really want to feel the benefits of the Dharma in our lives, and if we really want to enable us to create a better world for the sake of those that we share the world with, then we cannot relate to the Dharma as something on paper, something in our brains separate from So this emphasis on practicality of talent is so important, because we can't just sit around waiting for the Buddha to someday float down on the magic lotus and to just bless us and to wash away all our suffering away just like that by praying to him. Here's one thing that, you know, a lot of Buddhists have this wrong conception about the Buddha. I just want to make it very clear to all of you. The Buddha is not our God. He never was our God, he never will be our God. What is the Buddha then? The Buddha is our teacher, the one who shows us the path, the one who showed us the path. He came into our world to point out the truth. He pointed out the greatest potential that we humans could ever evolve to. But it's up to each and every one of us to put what he taught into action. He said, whatever I have taught, not just how to liberate yourselves from suffering, I have given you. It's up to all of you to walk that path. Say that the Buddha as our teacher, our doctor. What I sometimes like to say, he's not like our taxi driver. You know, if we want to go from here, from Toronto to Winnipeg, to Vancouver or somewhere, he's not going to drive us there just by giving us, just offering some dollars as well to take us there. No, he's the one that tells us exactly and specifically in details in the best way possible that first you go here, then you take the 108 long road, and then you go left, and you take a right, then you get this stop, then you go straight from there. All of those, that's what the Buddha chooses. We have to drive our own cars to get to that destination. And one thing that I want to make this clear, and coming to one of the questions, if you want to sum up the whole teachings of the Buddha, Buddha gave so many teachings and practices, 84,000 and so on, so many. But if you want to sum them up into one simple sentence, is that the Buddha is saying, is that you are a Buddha. Because we are. In reality, we're all Buddhas. Whatever he possesses or possesses, that Buddha nature, that true nature of Sukhavata, we possess that. We possess the same. There's no difference. Whether we like it or not, whether we're good, whether we're bad, that is our own right, and that's the true nature of ours. Even this insect has that Buddha nature. So, what makes us different from the Buddha? What is the one thing that makes us different from him? If we're all Buddhas, and if we possess the same potential, the same nature, what is it that we are here and he has attained that? One thing that makes us different is that he has realized he is a Buddha. We haven't because of all these clouds that I just mentioned, all these afflictive emotions such as anger, jealousy, these obscurations that all that are covering to see our true nature. And that's why we're stuck. That's why we're within this cycle. to win. That's why we meditate. That's why we try to purify all these negative emotions and afflictions and obscurations to realize something that we already possess. When you all become Buddhas in the future, there is no other place outside or any other place than the place you're sitting right now. It's a realization. And from that, we start to realize the true nature of the mind and the way things are. And from there, we are free. Free from all these chains that binds us to this cycle of suffering. That is what it is to be a Buddha. So yeah, when we are in a really bad soul, we bring someone that we know we see, like a shelter or a house and so on. Similarly, when we recognize this crazy, violent storm that we're in the middle of, with afflicted emotions and confusions and so on, we go for refuge to the Buddha as the one who can show us a safe passage out of this danger. See, we say going for refuge. Now, going for refuge, it means it's an ongoing process. A process until we become our own refuge. That's the goal. Now, coming back to one of the questions I think was written, you might be asking, if the Buddha is our teacher. There's this mention that he is the teacher, he is the one who showed us the path. Then who are these? And who is he? Buddha-sama? Who is Jesse? Who is Arama, Jushi? Who are these other figures? Why do we chant mantras? Why do we chant? Where do we ring bells? Why do we receive initiations? If our practice is about always focusing on the mind and within, why do we rely on all these outer stuff? Why do some deities look peaceful, some look wrathful, some look passionate, some have two eyes, some have three eyes, some have thousand eyes, some have two arms, six arms, thousand arms, some have a silver tongue, some have Shi, Hum, all these mantras of Om Mani Hum, Om Mani Padana Di, Om Tare Tukare. What are all these? To keep it very simple, to answer that, all of these are tools. They're all methods. They're all support for the main practice, which is to train our minds. For example, some people, they practice jhansi or Lokeshwara because they feel a special connection towards jhansi. They find the sadhanas, they find the mantras very calming, and they practice that. And they feel the benefits from it. Good for them. But some people don't feel that connection. Some people think it's not doing anything for them if they chant a mantra or practice jhansi. And in a way, that's okay. See, the reason why we have all these different practices and deities, so on, like I said, method, tools, because we are all different. In terms of that, we have different characteristics, we have different inclinations, dispositions, and we relate to different practices separately. So, like I said, some person who doesn't feel connection towards Jamesy, that's okay. Because that person might be able to feel more connection towards Dhara. So that person practices Dhara because that person feels more benefit and feels that during the mantra. peace and happiness. Some people might not feel that, then they go to Manjushri. See, we have all these different variety of practices for this reason. Some people might feel that all these deities are too peaceful, and then they don't feel a connection towards them, that they need something powerful, something wrathful, something forceful. So they go towards somebody like Rukamasamu or Vajrapani, Kalachaka, to practice something that's forceful enough to actually get rid of these afflictive emotions and confusions that we need to refrain and we need to get rid of. So, and the practices, all of them, they're just tools and support for all of us. It's like going to a buffet restaurant. You know, in a buffet restaurant, you have a variety of foods. Some people like noodles, they go for noodles. Some people like momos, they eat momos. Some people don't like momos, they can go eat rice and dal. Some people don't like them, they like to eat pizzas, like me. So, I mean, if you can eat all of them, gosh, good luck. But the main purpose is to get rid of your starvation. Similarly, all of these other practices have the same goal, which is to train our minds to be able to realize the nature of reality, our true nature. That's always been the goal. So yes, all of these are support. They're not real Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. I mean, does Jansi with four arms, with all these eyes and floating, is he really floating in the air in front of us? No. They're references for our minds because we as ordinary human beings, we have not got to that realization, even a slight one, to understand the nature of everything. We need support, we need objects, we need references. So that's why we have all of these. To have an object to visualize, to meditate on. Last year, a Tibetan lady came up to me and she said, Rutin, it's not good to have a Buddha statue in the bedroom, right? And I said, why not? I mean, as long as it's some kind of upper deck, you know, a table or a shrine, why not? And she said, you know. I said, no, I don't know. She said, in the bed, you know. I said, I don't know. And she said, me and my husband, you know. And I said, oh, now I know. Wait, why do I need to know? So she has this mindset that that is the Buddha. And she also said, when they do their business, what she does is she puts a cloth over the Buddha statue. Now I told her, okay, one, that's not a surveillance camera of the Buddha. Two, that's not the Buddha. Three, let's just say that it was. You think a cloth will block an enlightened being to see through? No, they are support, they are objects for our mind training. It's always been about that. So yes, coming back to the Buddha, so all these are one, they're all Buddhas. Just for our different practitioners like us, we want to have different visualizations and practices that can help train our mind. So that's what Buddha. Now the Dharma is the path itself, the teachings that Buddha gave to go out of, get rid of all these obscurations and defilements and so on. The Sangha means the companionship of bodhisattvas who help us walk the path to truth and freedom. And that doesn't mean invisible bodhisattvas like aliens or something like that. No. We actually have living bodhisattvas in our world guiding us, like His Holiness the Dalai Lama, like His Holiness Sajjan Gurujit and so on and so forth, and many other great female and male masters. And together, the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, they make up what we call the Triple Gem, the three refuges. So by going for refuge to them and from the heart, we are official Buddhists. Walkers of the way of wisdom and compassion that leads to liberation, that leads to enlightenment. So that's the whole reason why we go for refuge and what we as Buddhists are. We are all out. Coming to that topic, similarly to answer some of the questions, see, last week I was in California. I had an 11-hour flight from Korea, and the first day I arrived, I really was looking for it's been a while, so I wanted to go grab a all-American cheeseburger, vegetarian cheeseburger. So I went to a restaurant by myself, and I was eating, enjoying this burger. A few minutes later, a group of guys just came up. We had their roller skates and some tattoos and all that. So then they saw me, and they said, "Yo, it's one of them boys, yo. Yo, you are one of the, you know, the Dalai Lama guys." Yeah, also known as Tibetan. So he sat down with his other guys and started asking questions. And he was saying, "Oh, so you believe in God and stuff, right?" And I said, "No, I don't believe in God and stuff." And he said, "So, but you believe in something, like, see, my girlfriend is a religious person like you." And I said, "Oh, Grace, sorry to bring it to you, but I am not religious at all." Do you know the definition of religion? See, according to the dictionary, a religion means a strong belief in a supernatural power or powers that control human destiny. If that's the case, then we are not very religious, are we? So yeah, I said that, and he wanted to continue saying, like, "Okay, what if I said that God handed you this cheeseburger right now?" And I said, "Well, I think about it, I don't have anything to say about that." He said, "No, but what do you think?" Okay, if you're asking what I think, is that no, God or some higher power did not hand me this cheeseburger. That sweet lady in the counter over there called Cindy, she handed me this cheeseburger. But he was trying to get at something about what we believe in. So I said, "Okay, I get it. If you really want to, you know, you see, for us, it's not so much about what we believe in. For us, it's what we do that matters. But if you really want to know, let's just say, believe, what do we believe in? You could say, yes, we believe in this thing, this practice. We believe in this concept of karma. Good, the things that we do, good or bad, are neutral, produces results that matches the cause. So we try to live by that law. In a similar way, because we believe, have this belief through cause and effect, we also have this belief, the premise of rebirth, of previous life and afterlife. So he had the same question at Elijah. How do you prove that there is an afterlife or a previous life and the karma action does really bring that result? Now, I'll ask the same way that I asked to him and over here, because I can, yeah, sure, we can get into more details about the logic and reasoning of cause and effect and how it relates to previous life and afterlife. But what I answer him, and I'll answer the same thing here, is that does it matter? Does it really matter that there is really to prove that there is a previous life or afterlife? Does it really matter that karma, bad or good, does really bring those results? Because as long as with that normal way of believing that makes us a better human being, through that belief and through the practices, as long as it's bringing benefit, it brings peace to my life, to others as well, around my loved ones and people, if I can spread that love to others and to create a better world for others, it doesn't really matter. Because this practice, whatever it is, it's up to you to live and to check yourself if it really does changes your life and brings more joy and calm and makes you a better person. Because everything that the Buddha taught, it's never for us to believe just because he says it or just because it's written. But it's up to us to analyze it, to check through our own investigation, through our own human intelligence and scientific outlook, through our own human experience, to feel many ways we practice mindfulness, and this is something that I fear, anger, annoyed, caused by any kind of action from the outside. So this is one of the that I find effective practices that can change this whole thing around. And this is it's a practice on mindfulness. And it's a practice on mindfulness and vigilance that we need both together. And it's basically following the flow of the breath in and out through our whole body. Now you can sit comfortably however you want, on a chair, on a cushion, cross leg, as long as you're not too tight, not too loose, or just balance it. And just follow that flow of the breath in and out through your whole body, up and down. Because the majority of people in our world are stuck up here, dissociated what we're really feeling down here, dissociated what we're really feeling in the here and now. So this practice is what I feel that brings us back. And gives us back our territory, gives us back our ground. Because we are dissociating, we're really feeling down in the here and now, and what we're really being through a whole body. See, most people, when they think of meditation, they think it's all about here. That is a mistake. See, when we meditate through our whole body, our whole being. So when we first try this, just follow the breath in, out. What this does is not a body scanner. When we first try it, it might not make any sense. We might not feel certain things. Those feelings instead of being stuck in them.
recognize and we are aware that this is not part of my nature. You and your stirring emotions become separate. So we don't end up reacting, we respond. Because all these disturbing emotions, they're not part of our true nature. They're temporary clouds, they're temporary stains. Temporary stains that we can get rid of. See, for example, this table. Now, the dust on this table and the table itself, are they one nature? If it were one, you're not going to be able to wipe that off because it's part of his nature. But because we know that this dust and this table are not one nature, we know they're separate, then we try to rub it off and fight and clean it. Similarly, if all these emotions, anger, jealousy, fear, and all of them are part of our true nature, this whole thing is a waste of time. Dharma is a waste of time. But because they are not, because they are not who, then they don't define us who we are. They're not part of our nature. Recognizing that, being aware of that, we start to let them go. So recognizing it, feeling it. So, right now, it might not be so easy to have that confidence in the Buddha within us. Like a lot of us, if we look within, we find a lot of feeling. We find a lot of feelings, and all of them are not the kind of things that we're going to be okay with. But the good thing is that this is where the Buddha told us to start. He then asked us to start by believing in an idea about the origins of the universe or some invisible force that's supposed to have created it or anything like that. He encouraged us, like I mentioned this earlier before, to open our eyes, to open our hearts, to look directly at what we are feeling in the here and now. So this general thing is something that I feel and I think is so important as a foundation for any practice we do, any of this or anything you see or any activities that you do, I feel this is the foundation for all of that. Because to develop in the Dharma, maybe we want to explore the deeper teachings of the Dharma, to inquire about the nature of reality. But it won't be integrated, it won't go beyond concepts if we haven't opened the door of empathetic awareness. Maybe we want to learn how to do all these beautiful rituals and do all the chanting and the prayers, but it could just be a load of mumbo jumbo if we haven't set our hearts in the right direction first. Even if we want to meditate anything about voidness, emptiness, or visualization and so on, it will be a struggle to process all that's going on in the mind if we haven't got that mindfulness in our everyday life. So, yeah, life isn't easy sometimes. But if we put our energy, our trust in the foundations of wisdom and compassion like this, and then the positive, the potential of positive changes in our lives are really amazing. And it really does work. We can really calm the waves of the ocean and to discover really beautiful things between. All we have to do is practice. And this answer is similar to any of the other topics that some of the questions about whether you feel discouraged and so on, because anything that caused us to feel these from the outside, as long as we have dealt with the insight to these mind training activities or practices, we will gain more confidence, more courage to be able to be more motivated, because we're calm and clear and happy. Makes it so clear to recognize that this path will bring us to that goal that we all want. So, now when I say practice, it's not all about what goes on in our inner world. See, according to the Dharma, our inner world and outer world are interdependent. So if we're awakening love, compassion, wisdom, and so on, it has to express itself. You know, we have to dream out loud. So, and we, allow me to say we are the generation that has to act, and act now to create changes inside and out. To, if we keep and use the resources of the world that we have, and our dreams to really feel, to really to come true. Coming back to one of the questions, sorry, about death. So, see, just the word death, it instantly conjures up an uncomfortable feeling for a lot of people. do that, we will not be panic-stricken or anguished at a time of death, but we will sustain the attentive presence that we need to recognize the nature of the world. So yeah, life is about death and impermanence. But in this life, we can realize transcendence, something that's beyond birth and death. What time is it? Sorry.
Oh, I'm very sorry.
A few words just want to conclude this. See, looking around at this gathering today and yesterday, or you know, whether it's the Sacramento or any festival or His Holiness Lyon's birthday and so on, it's something that always makes me happy. It's something that, you know, I feel uplifted and moved to share. It's such an expression of our spiritual and cultural freedom as we're able to experience it right here and enjoy it. And I'm always particularly moved during such occasions as I'm reminded of the immense hardships, the energy, the love, the sacrifice that so many Tibetans have given, and by His Holiness the Dalai Lama especially, so that we can experience it and enjoy the full experience and expression of what it is to be Tibetan without constraint. So, although it's a very joyful gathering to come together, auspicious to come together and do all of this, but still I want to admit that there's something a bit heavy that there's the background for all of us, which is something that any displaced people are present with every day. The awareness of the loss, the tragedy, the pain that all of our families have experienced in having to preserve this rich spiritual tradition and this culture that, you know, outside of our homeland. So I want to acknowledge that. I want to acknowledge this because it's such an awareness that must inspire, if not compel, the younger generation of Tibetans, like myself, to take seriously the continuation, the preservation of Tibetan language, spirituality, culture, and so on and so forth. And what His Holiness and our parents, our grandparents, and all our compatriots of yesterday have handed down to us, a very precious inheritance, and we must not let it go to waste. In fact, we all need to feel proud of who we are. And His Holiness has said this again and again, and even more the last few years, that His hope is in the younger generations. And not just for the Tibetan community, actually, but across the globe in tackling the great unresolved issues of our time, social injustice, human rights, dignity, poverty, environment, corruption, and conflict, and so on. For example, like with an issue of the environment. See, once a Tibetan parent in a family, I've seen the parents say to their son called Dashi, he started saying, "Dashi, it's your turn to take up recycling. We're trying to do our bit here for the environment. Move it already." And Dashi over here is like, "Oh gosh, I can't. I'm in the middle of a call of duty. My squad needs me. Can somebody else do it?" See, Dashi, and we understand that, Dashi would be only concern for a connection to his community, to his family, to his world. But Maggie, maybe not. But similarly, I have to say, I kind of cringe every time when, from the inside, when, for instance, some families come up to me and tell their children very forcefully that, oh no, prostitution, get missing children. Like, almost from the start. And there have been cases where parents come up to me and said, Richard, my son is too wild. He just plays on his video games all day. My daughter is just lazy, watching kid drama all day. You know, they have no interest in Buddhism. They don't want to go to the monastery. How can I make them? My gosh, make them? How can you make anybody do something like, I mean, blackmail? Handcuffs? No. You can't make anybody want to go to the monastery or make them do these, you know, Buddhist practices. And even if you manage to make them forcefully to do all of that, is it really gonna, you know, help their minds and help transform their minds and heal their hearts? And unless they really want to practice the Dharma, because that's what it's actually for. So now, in such cases, we get it. We understand it. That it's never a bad intent behind it. Quite the opposite. See, it's the family's pure wish to respect and maintain their spirituality and their culture, or what they feel to be wholesome and noble, because they found it so much benefit. They found so much benefit from it themselves. But when we're faced with a world that is in constant flux, a world that is so technology dependent, so cosmopolitan, so oftentimes stressfully fast paced, it's now more than ever that we have to support each other in positive intervals through listening and skillful communication. That connection, that's the connection I was talking about. The thing that if we're not careful, we can lose. So, for example, not so long ago, I had a couple of meetings with some young Buddhist children, and which I really enjoyed. First time, we talked about the importance of kindness, patience, generosity, and so on. Then most recently, we ended up focusing more on Buddhist communication skills, on connections, and that was amazing. And it's actually a really important part of our Buddhist way of life, because, and especially for Mahayana practitioners in the tradition. But I have to say, it's a bit of a neglected part of our teaching repertoire. If we advertise along giving a long life empowerment, it's standing room only. You'll see it tomorrow. But a communication workshop? I mean, I guess you at least have room to stretch your legs. So, His Holiness has said this, and I just try to echo it as much as I can. I mentioned this earlier, that we need to be 21st century Buddhists in fostering a really well-informed rather than superficial or lip service approach to our ethical and spiritual commitment. Similarly, I really want to encourage all of us to take connection and communication skills seriously. We're supporting each other in a So, yeah, so this connection is about really listening. It's about listening to and empathizing with each other's needs, and about empathizing each other's feelings, aspirations, and so on, without judgment, without inhibition. It enables us, it enforces our ability to be more accommodating, to be more adaptable across the generations. So I believe those two approaches, connecting and being 21st century with this, and those two approaches will empower the younger generation, my generation, I should say, that to honor our elders' knowledge, our elders' wishes and legacy in a way that feels fully cooperative, that feels innovative, that feels fulfilling in our lives. So in this regard, and because due to time, I have to apologize. I just want to say one last thing. And I want to say to my younger Tibetan sisters and brothers, and in fact, to all my people, is that although sometimes, of course, the lamas might appear to be a bit remote on the high thrones and so busy with all their teaching activities at home and overseas, but we are, from the bottom of my heart, I can say this, we are all here for you. And from my side, I can try as best I can, and I'll do it, and I'm here for all of you. There's no question that you can ask, there's no problem you cannot share, no agenda, no expectations. If you want, you just listen. You can talk to me in Tibetan, you can talk to me in English, you can talk to me in French, you can talk to me in Italian. You can talk to me in Swahili, God, if you can find me a translator, I'll be there. Just know that I am here. And in the same way, I trust in my heart that I can count on you the same way as part of a wider Tibetan Buddhist family to ensure that that our heritage is safe and it will bring immeasurable benefits to the world. I want to express my heartfelt gratitude and appreciation for all of you to make this happen, to invite us this beautiful program, and I hope to come back again before too long. Thank you so much.
For engaging with such openness and giving us